would decline. Because the notice must be served at the registered address. And the registered address you'll find from the address clause of the Memorandum of Association. So before you proceed with or against the company, please find out the Memorandum of Association, observe, inspect, then only proceed. Tomorrow, if you want to sue a company in a court of law, you have to make party's name and address. There also, you will have to use the registered name and registered address. If the summons are to be served, they have to be served at the registered address, not at the corporate or branch address or whatever. But that will be considered as not served. Third is object clause. What is the objective of a company? Ye kyun banayi ja rahi hai? To object clause could, as a lawyer tomorrow, maybe you will be engaged to do this paperwork to kind of draft a memorandum for the company. So you have to remember, drafting of a memorandum is a skill. Because aap initially kisi ek objective ko lekar company bana rahe hain. लेकिन फ्यूचर में अगर आप अपने बिजनेस को डाइवर्सिफाई करना चाहते हैं, दूसरे ब्रांचेस में भी अपनी दुकान खोलना चाहते हैं, और अगर मेमोरेंडम के ऑब्जेक्ट क्लॉज में वो बिजनेस नहीं है, तो आप नहीं कर पाएंगे. आपने ऑब्जेक्ट क्लॉज में समोसा लिखा है, और जब समोसा खाने ग्राहक आ रहा है तो कह रहा है सर चाय मिलेगी, फिर आपको रियलाइज हो रहा है हाँ यार चाय भी बनानी चाहिए. लेकिन अगर आप कंपनी में चाय बनाना चाहेंगे और ऑब्जेक्ट क्लॉज में नहीं लिखा हुआ है, देन योर चाय विल बिकम अल्ट्रावायरस. अल्ट्रावायरस टू द मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन इटसेल्फ. तो इस वजह से जब आप को एंगेज किया जाए एज ए लॉयर टू ड्राफ्ट अ मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन, ऑब्जेक्ट क्लॉज को दो हिस्सों में डिवाइड किया जाता है, द मेन ऑब्जेक्ट एंड द सब्सिडियरी ऑब्जेक्ट. और सब्सिडियरी ऑब्जेक्ट में आप फ्यूचरिस्टिक बिजनेस के बहुत सारे प्रपोजिशंस को लिख के रखते हैं कि मेन ऑब्जेक्ट समोसा बनाना है पर चाय भी बना सकते हैं. और जब आप देखेंगे किसी मेमोरेंडम को एक्चुअली प्रैक्टिकली, विच आई एक्सपेक्ट यू मस्ट स्टार्ट इंस्पेक्टिंग सर्टेन मेमोरेंडम्स ऑफ कंपनीज, तो आपको कमाल कमाल की इंटरेस्टिंग चीजें पता चलेंगी. फ्रॉम द मेन ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ मेकिंग समोसा, इफ यू गो इन द सब्सिडियरी ऑब्जेक्ट, पता चलेगा दैट वन ऑफ द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ द कंपनी इज टू मेक फिल्म्स आल्सो. अनदर सब्सिडियरी ऑब्जेक्ट, इफ यू कीप ऑन सर्चिंग, यू मे फाइंड दैट दिस समोसा मैन्युफैक्चरर वन डे इंटेंड्स टू बी एन आर्म्स डीलर आल्सो. वो तोप बनाना चाहता है. बिकॉज देयर इज नो लिमिट व्हाट अ कंपनी कैन डू. सो डोंट प्रोहिबिट द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ अ फ्यूचर बिजनेस. सो अ गुड ड्राफ्टमैनशिप इज दैट यू कंटिन्यू टू मेक अ लिस्ट ऑफ व्हाट एवर पॉसिबल अंडर द सन दैट द कंपनी कैन डू बिजनेस. सो दैट सपोज फ्यूचर इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डाइवर्सिफाई बिजनेस और वेंचर आउट इन टू एन एरिया which is not your primary objective, you can do and does not become ultra-virus to the object of the memorandum of association. Is that clear? Moving ahead, then comes the capital clause, which indicates what is the capital of the company. But remember, the capital clause of the memorandum of association will only indicate the nominal capital of the company and not the issued, subscribed and paid up capital, because that is the capital which is like the boundary line of which with which the company is beginning, and no company begins with an entire capital being issued. So a portion of that capital is actually issued later, subscribed and paid up. But that you will find somewhere else, not in the memorandum of association. In the memorandum of association, the authorized capital only is being found. What is the authorized capital of the company under the capital clause? Then comes the subscription clause. What is the subscription clause? Who are the promoters of the company? Under the subscription clause, there are signatures of those who have primarily formed the company, who incorporated the company. So by that, and those are the initial directors of the company, those promoters. So from that subscription clause, you come to know about the promoters and initial directors of the company. Now, before we move forward, there's an important aspect which you must remember, that all these clauses can be altered. So all this is alterable, amendable. You can amend, you can alter. And there's a whole procedure for alteration of the clauses of memorandum prescribed, predominantly by passing a special resolution. Earlier, there were many more formalities for alteration in 1956 Act, which has been refined in 2013 Act, and predominantly it has been limited as a company's internal affair, because earlier you had to kind of take permission of the central government, and some alteration you had to go to company law board or court to seek permission to alter. All that has been now refined, and it has been rendered as an internal affair of the company to alter by passing predominantly a special resolution. Now, moving ahead, the next document is Articles of Association. First is Memorandum of Association. The second is Articles of Association. Now, what is Articles of Association? It's different from Memorandum. Memorandum is a charter, which is actually a document which is giving introduction of a company to the world at large. Against that, Articles of Association is a set of rules prescribing the internal management system of a company. Like a building has an outer structure, and then it has internal design. So from an outer structure, you do not know how many rooms this building has and how to enter from which door to which room. That is internal architecture of that building. Similarly, the first document of the company is like the outer structure, Memorandum of Association. The internal structure, dimensions of internal rules and regulations, is Articles of Association. Now, can Articles of Association be altered as well? Yes. Now, in 2013 Act, by passing a special resolution, you can alter your articles also. And you have to keep altering your articles in so many areas. It's a very common feature which you have, because without articles being allowing you to do certain acts, you can't do. And like I said, that if you are indulging into any act which is violative to the Memorandum of Association, that is considered as ultra vires to the memorandum. And that reminds me, that is a leading case of Ashbury Carriage Company versus Rish. Ashbury, A-S-H-B-U-R-Y. Ashbury Carriage Company versus Rish, R-I-C-H-E. What had happened in this company was that the company was, in the object clause of the company, the main business of the company was shown as laying as manufacturers of railway wagons. But they enter into a contract for laying down the railway track in Belgium. Later on, they rescinded the contract. When the matter reached to court, they took a defense that because why this contract was rescinded was because it was ultra vires to the memorandum. Object clause does not talk about laying down the railway track. It only talks about manufacturing of railway wagons. And the court upheld that yes, the contract can be terminated because the object clause does not talk about laying down the railway tracks. So that is where, by this Ashbury Railway Carriage Company versus Risch, a leading case, and the doctrine of ultra vires emerged. And please remember, doctrine of ultra vires is a very important doctrine. And the ultra vires can be ultra vires to the memorandum of association. Action of the company can be ultra vires to the statute, Companies Act, as well as the action of the company can be ultra vires to the articles of association also.
Which year it was upheld?
What?
Belgium.
1800. Right? Now, when you are dealing with a company, like I said, you have to go through these documents of memorandum of association. You also will have to go through the articles of the company. Because if you are entering into a contract with a company, you are expected to know the company. Like, for example, if you are entering into a contract with another person, you're supposed to know that person. If you want to do a business deal with another individual, aren't you expected to know him? Or what is his solvency or financial position? Or for a marriage proposal, if two persons are to be married, aren't they supposed to know each other? Or maybe the families must know each other. Similarly, if you're entering into a contract with a company, it is expected that you know the company well. And that is where a doctrine of constructive notice emerged. It's a very important doctrine, doctrine of constructive notice. By this doctrine, it is established that whether you have actually gone through these documents or not, you are expected to have gone through before entering into a contract. The word constructive comes out of the word to construe. To construe means to believe that you have gone through. You know the company. So that means you have the notice that this is the memorandum of the company, these are the articles, this is the area in which the company can do business, and therefore you entered into a contract. So if you, despite knowing, enter into a contract which is beyond the jurisdiction of the company, you are hit by doctrine of ultra vires. So these two doctrines work in tandem. Doctrine of ultra vires as well as doctrine of constructive notice. So for a person who is entering into the contract with a company, that person has to be extremely careful. But there's another doctrine as a savior of the person who's entering into a contract with a company. These two doctrines support the company. But the third doctrine is doctrine of indoor management.